I'd like to introduce you to the Tomb of Ligeia, which I think is one of the best of the Edgar Allan Poe pictures I made. Elizabeth played the lead in the Tomb of Ligeia. She was a brilliant actress, beautiful then and beautiful today.
It is a real honor for me, and a thrill, I may say, to be sitting here with the one and only Roger Corman. I will always be grateful that he entrusted those two roles to me in that movie, which indeed was a Roger Corman epic. We talked earlier about films being made in 2 days or 5 days. We had 5 weeks.
It was 5 weeks, but you have to understand how you work in England. You show up and you start shooting, and suddenly you break to eat for 11. You shoot a little bit longer, you break for lunch. You shoot a little bit longer, you break for tea. And I said on the first film I did in England, and asked at the Red Death, when do we shoot? We're eating all day long. The Tomb of Ligeia is noted, at least for me, for a film in which I threw out all of my theories. I had certain theories about Edgar Allan Poe and how the film should be made. I felt that Poe, in a similar way to the 19th century, to Freud, was working with the unconscious mind. And I felt that the unconscious mind does not directly perceive the world. It gets information from the eyes, the ears, the nose, and so forth. So I felt I will shoot everything on a soundstage. And when I do go out for an occasional shot, I will somehow distort reality. And on the very first of the pictures, The Fall of the House of Usher, I needed a scene where the young leading man rides up to the House of Usher. There was a forest fire in the Hollywood Hills, and I put together overnight a 5-man crew and went out into the still smoldering forest and shot that. It was always artificial. I felt I must stay away from reality. On Tomb of Ligeia, I got tired of my own theory, and I said, not only are we going outside, we're going outside in the beautiful English countryside and shooting in broad daylight. And the film, on that basis, is one of the best looking of the films because it had a broader viewpoint. And Elizabeth was equally good on a horse in the English countryside, as well as with Vincent on the soundstage.
I had to learn to ride side saddle, which actually I found was easier than astride. I'm not a horsewoman myself, but the way the side saddle is constructed, you could hook one leg over on this side and then brace yourself with the saddle on the other. So it was quite thrilling. I wasn't supposed to do so much riding, but in the end I did everything except the hunt and the jump. So it was, you always learn something new on every movie.
Now, we'd be happy to answer any questions. Does anybody have a, yes?
Yeah, Mr. Corman, what I was gonna say to you is that what's great is that you had Robert Towne as your screenwriter.
Yes.
For this, and this is how you start everybody, and then he ended up doing Chinatown, but before that he did the garden scene in The Godfather with Al Pacino and Marlon Brando. I mean, just amazing how you made Dick Miller, and you made everybody. So I just want to say how great you are.
Well, Bob, I want to say how great a writer Bob Towne is. He wrote Chinatown, Shampoo, Ghost Grid wrote a number of other scripts that are credit to other people. He's really one of the major screenwriters of the last 50 years.
I think that is one reason why this film has really stood the test of time so well, because it is a wonderful script, and it's a beautiful love story. So it really gave Vincent and I something to get our teeth into, and the emotional stakes are higher than in some of the other movies. And so you really get to know the people. And I have to say that it was a joy to work with Vincent Price, a magnificent actor, I think underestimated as a classical actor, and charming man. Rowena had no problem falling in love with Burdenfell, I can tell you.
Roger, can you say a quick word about working with Vincent?
Yes, Vincent, as Elizabeth has said, was a brilliant actor. He had been, he was an American who studied, and he went to Yale here, studied acting there, then went to the University of London and first appeared on the stage in London. So he was a classically trained actor. He was also a highly intelligent man and very funny. He was just a pleasure to work with.
Next, we can take one or two more questions maybe beforehand. Yeah, go ahead.
Yeah, hi, Mr. Corman. These films, the Poe films you did, were so popular nationally and internationally. Did you ever consider doing another one after Tumult Ligeia, and which one would it have been if you did consider it?
I considered several. It was a Poe film that wasn't a horror story. It was sort of a horror science fiction story, the narrative of A. Gordon Pym. But I felt that I really said all I had to say with the Poe films, and I felt I was in danger of repeating myself. Maybe I did repeat myself to a certain extent, and this was the early 60s, and I wanted to move out of the studio, which I did partially, as I said, with Ligeia. But then I said, I want to get completely out of the studio. I want to go into the streets and shoot the counterculture, the things that were happening in the 60s. That led to The Wild Angels, The Trip, and a number of other films that were completely away from studio work.
Okay, and one more question before we... Yeah, go for it.
Oh, as I understand it, this is shot in an actual abbey.
Yes.
And what was that like for both of you? And which abbey would this be in?
It was, Elizabeth knows England clearly better than I. Was it East End?
It was in Norfolk.
Oh, I see.
Yes, Castle Acre was the name. It's a heritage, beautiful heritage ruin, and beautifully kept. I think we had to sort of mess it up a little bit. And of course we had to build the tomb, but it added tremendous atmosphere. And so on the outside, it's all Castle Acre. And then we open the door, and then we're in the studio.
And scouting that location, I rented a car, and there was some special deal at this car rental place in London for the weekend. There was unlimited mileage. You could pick it up Friday afternoon and return it on Sunday. So I picked it up, and I had all of these. I checked with there's some English Heritage Society or something like that. They gave me a list of all the appropriate castles, ruined abbeys, and so forth. And I set off, I went into the Midlands, went to Wales, went up to Northumberland, came back down to Norfolk, back to London, and the guy looked at the mileage and he said, you set the all-time record for renting a car for the weekend.
Thank you, Bob.
I would just like to say that working with Mr. Corman, because he himself had studied acting, he understood the actor's process. And so before the movie, He would talk to us so that we were all on the same page about the character and how we were going to tell the story. And then he entrusted the roles to us. But we also knew that because he was so wonderful at composing the shots, that he would be telling the story as eloquently, visually, as we were trying to do emotionally. So it was the most enormous pleasure to work with him.